In this video, I will talk about the scientific part of the proposal that is referred to as Part B2. This is the part where the panel dig deep into your proposal. My name is Anne Nielsen, and I work as a scientific officer in the area of social sciences and humanities at the executive agency of the European Research Council. In other videos, you have heard what to think about when writing an ERC proposal, what questions to ask yourself before the process, how to fill in the administrative part, as well as how to complete Part B1. In this video, I will cover what to consider when writing Part B2. You may intuitively think that it makes most sense to write Part B2 after you have done Part A and Part B1. But actually, many people prefer to start with Part B2 and then write B1 afterwards. A bit like you would write the abstract for a paper only after you wrote the paper itself. Part B2 is where the panel will look into the methodology of your project and also how you place yourself in the state of the art. So it's really important that you have done your homework well. It's up to you to tell the panel exactly what you expect to do and what your work plan is. Explore your hypothesis and any supporting evidence, if you have it. Write and rewrite your proposal until you're fully satisfied with it. To make sure reviewers understand your project, I will give you 5 tips to guide you when writing Part B2. The first tip is to make sure you clearly explain the quantitative and qualitative differences to the state of the art. What do you hope to achieve with your project? How is it different from what has already been done? And how well do you know your field? Of course, make sure you reference properly. The second tip is to provide alternative strategies to mitigate risks. You would be surprised how little risk assessment people include in proposals, but this actually has to be done really well. One thing to point out though, is that while it's important to include risk assessment, we do not need us to see a dissemination or a management plan, unlike for other European grants. The third tip is to make sure there is an obvious link between Part B1 and B2. Do not spend all the effort on Part B1 and then present a rough B2. This disappoints the reviewers, which is something you should avoid. It is better to start from writing Part B2, do it really well, and then focus on B1. The fourth tip is to make use of the evaluation criteria to structure your proposal. This means you could even use them as headings. For example, use groundbreaking nature, potential impact, and scientific approach as headers, or as trains of thought running through the proposal. The fifth tip is to make the proposal easy to read and attractive. Write your proposal in a way that is understandable, also to people that are not necessarily experts within your specific field of research. Use paragraphs, correct typos, and maybe ask a native speaker to have a look at the text. The language will not be what makes or breaks a proposal, but just make sure you don't have any mistakes, because it does tend to make the proposal look careless. Check the coherence of figures, use the full space available, and make sure you give full references. Remember, they're excluded from the page limit, so make them easily readable. Make sure you include a timeline that has information on the people you will employ. And make sure you justify your resources and explain your budget properly. Now that I've explained the 5 things to think about when writing the Part B2 of your ERC proposal, let's have a look at some of the other things you will need to consider in this part. The panel focuses on budget analysis only in step 2 of the evaluation process. Panels have to ensure that the resources requested are reasonable and well justified, so they look at everything in detail. At the same time, they do not micromanage your project's finances. For example, they will look at how many postdocs you want to include in the project and whether this is reasonable. A good tip is to make sure you ask for funding for open access, as this is compulsory. If the panel considers that there should be cuts made to the budget, these are justified on a proposal-by-proposal basis. Panels are not allowed to cut across the board to reach a certain budget. Some tend to think that the more you ask, the more you will get. This is not correct. The budget requested should match what is needed for the work planned, and there's no punishment of proposals that ask for amounts that are lower. Some also think that you should ask for as much as you can because the panel will make cuts regardless. This is definitely not true. If you falsely inflate the budget, you won't be able to justify it appropriately, something which the panel will certainly realize. The work program and information for applicants include the specifics about what you should consider in terms of open access in two regards: your publications and also your research data. The guidelines can change, so make sure you read this information thoroughly when preparing your proposal. Please do not wait to submit until the last minute, and do not leave proofreading until the very last day. Make sure you save a version of your proposal on the portal, and then you can submit and resubmit different versions up until the deadline. A submitted proposal will override any previous version, so do this to avoid losing all your work. Only the final version uploaded before the deadline will be considered. Once you press submit, all you need to do is wait. Now it's our turn to do the work. I want to share with you also the five typical reasons for a rejected proposal. The project can be too narrow or too broad and unfocused. The project is incremental research. The project is a collaborative effort between several PIs. Or there's not enough information, meaning the proposal isn't detailed enough. Or there isn't a sufficient risk management strategy. There are also three typical reasons for rejection based on the researcher's profile: insufficient track record, or insufficient potential for independence, or insufficient experience leading projects. Especially if you're a less senior researcher applying for a starting grant, explain how you're independent from your supervisor and how you'll split the work if you collaborate with them. Finally, if you feel like you should redress the decision of the panel, please think about it and consider some of the things in this video. The redress process is not there to tackle scientific disagreement. It exists in case the panel has made a mistake, and it should not be taken lightly. This is the end of this video. I gave you five important things to consider when writing Part B2, which should guide you when writing this part of the proposal. And please remember, it's a good idea to start with this part first and write the Part B1 afterwards. A few months after submission, successful applicants will receive an invitation to attend an interview. If you're interested in the interview process, make sure you check out our video, How to Prepare for an ERC Interview, and all our other videos on the application process.